Okay, hello everybody, dear colleagues, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night. Let's start our seminar for today. Today we have our speaker is Evgeny Mukhlin from the United States. The exact place, Evgeny, what is?
Indianapolis.
In Indianapolis, and your talk, title of your talk is?
Is here.
Okay.
So yes, you have to find this icon with my page and pin it so that you can listen to it.
Okay. Please, you can start, Evgeny.
I can start. All right. Well, thank you very much. Mm-hmm. It's always a pleasure to talk in Brazil. Okay, even though I'm not in Brazil right now, certainly I would prefer to be on this beautiful campus in Sao Paulo or somewhere else, maybe on a beach there or somewhere, but okay, I can do only virtual talk today. But nevertheless, it's my great pleasure and I'm very happy to give such a talk. So my talk today is actually based on a joint work with my former PhD student, Luan Bezerra. And Luan is currently actually in Brazil on a job market. So I would rather, I hope people take note of this because already Europe is trying to steal him, I think. And in US, unfortunately, he cannot stay because of the visa situation. So I think if you guys have a chance, you should go after him. So we wrote already three papers, and my talk is actually based mainly on a third paper. And this third paper, we decided not to put online just yet. We are going to do it next week, because nowadays, you know, there's a very bad trend, in my opinion, when people don't listen to a talk, but rather go online and just look at the paper and compare it and so on and so on. So I don't give you such a chance. If you want to find a mistake in what I'm saying, you have to listen to the talk and not to look at the paper. So anyways, so what is it about? I'll try somehow to give you some idea about combinatorics, which is actually behind the representation theory of quantum toroidal algebras. And so let me start very simple with partitions. Okay, so partitions. I think everybody probably knows what partition is. I even asked my family, and everybody knows what partition is in my family. Okay, well, my wife maybe thinks that partition is actually an office divider. So it's something which divides the office into pieces. But even that is, I think, slightly is a correct version of what partition is. Usually by a partition, we mean a number. We mean how to break, say, a number into a number of summons. Okay, 5 plus 3 plus 2. So this is a simple way of partitioning 10. And so there are many, many partitions of 10, you can imagine, and we don't care about the order of numbers. And so such things are actually nice, but the best way is to represent them by a Young diagram. And so Young diagram is always like this. So you have 5, the largest part of your partition is on the top. Then you have 3 here, and then you have 2 here. And so this is a partition of 10, which corresponds to 5 plus 3 plus 2. Okay, well, anyways, so maybe let me just, okay, so here's a list of all partitions of 4. So there are partitions which are 4 as a 1 summoned, 3 plus 1, 2 plus 2, 2 plus 1 plus 1, 1 plus 1 plus 1. And so there are totally 5 partitions of 4. And so the Young diagrams are listed right here. And so, okay, everybody knows probably, I don't want to spend time on this. So there is even partition function. So this partition function counts the number of partitions with n parts. So if Pn stands for the number of partitions with n, of number n, not n parts, sorry, with n boxes. So 4 boxes and means partition of 4 here. If I take Pn, this is the number of partitions of 4 boxes, then such a generating series can be compactly written as 1 over with the Dedekind function, if you wish. And this is combinatorially just 1 over 1 minus q, 1 minus q squared, 1 minus q cubed, and so on and so on. This is a very clear and simple formula. If you expand it, you'll get 1 plus q plus q squared, and so you just get 1 plus q squared. So this is expanding 1 minus q. Then you get 1 plus q squared plus q to the fourth plus q to the sixth. And so this is expanding 1 minus q squared, and so on. And when you multiply it out, this counts the parts of the partition of length 1, of parts of length 2, and so on. And so this is actually a very obvious statement which we have. So now what I want is the following. I want to ask the question, can we have a supersymmetric analog of such partitions? Okay, so this is maybe a slightly naive question. So certainly this is a very popular thing to do right now. Everything has to have supersymmetric analogs. And as we know, supersymmetry plays an important part in life, in physics model, in mathematics, everywhere. And so this is a question, okay, at the moment maybe it is naive. Later we will see that actually comes from somewhere. But anyways, how do I find supersymmetric analog of that? Well, if you think about it just a couple of seconds, probably you already can answer this question. Well, so what do we have here? A partition is just a sequence of numbers, of parts, nu1 plus nu1, nu2, nu n, and so the sum of them is the number which we are partitioning, and they are weakly increasing. So they can be equal, or this is bigger than that. That's what we have. And these are natural numbers, and for me, natural numbers do not include zero. So they start from one and go to infinity. So anyways, so this is my partition. And so how to make supersymmetric analog? So I can think about nu1, nu2, nu n like being bosonic or even variables. That's why when I do, you know, multiplication, I am allowing to multiply them. But if some of them, I say, are fermions, then I shouldn't be able to have two of them at the same time. So this is kind of Fermi statistics. You can't have two fermions because product of a fermion squared is, you know, fermion squared is always zero. And so how do we do it? So what we do is we choose parities. And so the parities are, well, just numbers plus or minus one, one, two, three. And so, I mean, there are many, many parities. And so basically what we say is that S1 says, if it's plus one, it means that one is a boson. So I can repeat it. And if S1 is minus one, then I cannot repeat it. So here, for example, one is repeated four times. And so, okay, if it was a fermion, I would not have such a super partition. And then I just prohibit. Yeah, that's what I just said. So I can prohibit things. So I cannot have two equal things if it's a fermion. It's just not allowed. And then, okay, I have super partitions, if you wish. And and so these super partitions, in some words, I mean, okay, this is just counting a basis in a ring. So when xi is just usual polynomial variables commuting, and psi j are supercommuting. And so those correspond to minus one parity, this corresponds to one parity. Okay, and then it's very easy to write down the partition function. It's the same thing. So now if you have a boson, if you have a bosonic particle, which you can repeat, you still have a factor 1 minus q to the power I. So these are the ones which corresponds to SI equal 1. And if SI equals minus 1, okay, you can repeat it only once. So instead of this factor, you have such a factor on the top. And so, okay, compactly, this formula is written like this. So this formula is the same, like that. All right. So, and this is actually has been done before. Again, people just don't think twice. They just do it because it's a basis in such an algebra. And the term superpartition is now reserved for such a generalization of partitions. Well, so somehow what I'm going to talk today is a slightly different analog of super analog of partitions. So this is maybe a good thing, but not for the purposes of my talk. Okay, so let me now tell you how I would like to do this superpartition thing differently. So for that, I have to tell you first about boson-fermion correspondence. Maybe you all know what it is, but nevertheless. Combinatorially, this is very simple, actually. And so what you do is you have a partition, and you cut it differently. So previously, we cut it along rows. And so this is row 9 boxes, 7 boxes, 7 boxes, 5, 2, 1, 1. That's what our partition was. But now I'm going to cut it differently. I'm going to take this red diagonal, and I'm going to count boxes to the right of that and to the left of that. So you see, to the right of that, there is 8.5, 6.5, 5.5, 3.5. Okay, this should be 1 + 1/2. Anyways, this is 6.5, 3.5, 1.5, 1.5. And so this is just a different way. Instead of decoding lengths of rows, I'm now encoding what I have here. And so, in other words, a partition in different ways can be written like this. I have lambdas and mu's. So these are lambdas, these are mu's. And so lambdas and mu's, they are half integers, non-negative, positive half integers. And now you see they are always greater than each other. So they cannot repeat. So you see, for example, this and this, they are the same rows, but here's 6.5 and here's 5.5. So you cannot repeat it. So in other words, instead of having as a number of bosons, I have number of fermions already. Lambdas are fermions and mu's are fermions. Important part is, okay, you have to say this is charge +1, this is charge -1, and this is charge 0. So the number of rows and number of columns here is always the same. You see, same number n here and here. And so this is just a different way to think about the partition. So instead of thinking about bosons, you can think about fermions. So this is very, very common in, conformal field theory or vertex separators, algebras, or something. So many of you probably know it, but this is just a way to present it combinatorially. And thinking like that, actually, it leads to a different fermionic partition formula. So the formula is like this. So you have same partition function as before. So now you represent it like that. So you see, the rule is this. So what you have is, you have a partition, you cut it into two pieces. And so these guys are fermions, but if you delete this staircase here and delete staircase here, what is left here is the usual partition. And the usual partition with n parts definitely has character 1 over qn. This is 1 over qn. This total is qn squared. Okay, this is actually called by combinatorials by Dufresne squares. But in any case, it just gives you such a formula. And qn is just, again, a symbol like this, and this is n going from 0 to infinity. So this is n is the size of the square. In this case, n would be 4, for example, for here. And so this is such a formula. Okay, so this formula is nice and good and so on. However, it can be improved. Namely, I can introduce grading. So this grading is actually very popular in combinatorics, and not only in combinatorics. There is a reason for this, which I will explain later. But the grading is like this. Okay, so this actually corresponds to n equal 1, but let me now choose n equal 4. So if I choose n equal 4, then I'm going to grade it by 4 colors. So 0, 1, 2, and 3. There are four colors of four different labels here. And so I always start here. And okay, in fact, start can be arbitrary, but okay, let me start with 0 here. And then I increase numbers this direction. And then I decrease numbers this direction. And so doing like that, every partition has a labeling. So I can put numbers in every box here. And then the weight of the partition depends on 4 letters because there are 4 different colors. And it just counts the number of boxes of that color. So Z0 cubed because there are 3 zeros in that. Z1 to the fourth because there are 4 ones here. Z2 to the fourth, and so on. So this is the weight of that diagram, depends on four letters. Now, if I put all zi equals to q, then I'll get q to the power 14. That's how we counted it in the previous formula. In the previous formula, we counted only number of boxes, and we didn't care about colors. And so this is called principal gradation. And so this is just the gradation which comes from representation theory. And so now the question is, how do I count the number, the partition functions, which depends on Z0, Z1, Z2, Z3. And actually, it's not difficult at all. And that's called fermionic formula, really the fermionic formula as we understand it. And so it's done like this. So if I denote AI number of rows adding and I, BI number of columns adding and at I, so this is I. So for example, this is adding and 2. So here A2 would be 2. And B2 we would be 0, no columns, adding at 2. So then we have these numbers, and so number of sum of AIs is the sum of all columns. Number of all columns is rows is equal to number of columns, so these are equal. And so if I introduce this notation P, then it's very easy to write down the formula. So it's somewhat maybe long, but it's very. So this is exactly, you know, this piece which was previously shown here and here, and this piece on the top, that's what replaces this square. You see, if you have AI, so these are I numbers. So what you want to do is you don't want to repeat the same index twice. Because of not repetition, you have to put staircase. This is a staircase part. This is here. But then what you want to do is you want to also find the lowest configuration in all this business. So anyways, this is the weight of the lowest configuration, which has AI of rows ending at I, BI columns ending of I. This is the lowest configuration. And after that, this is just the usual formula. So this is not a deep formula. And let me not spend here too much time. Let me just go forward. So anyways, why such a gradation? So OK, again, I'm not going to representation theory too deep yet. But if you know what is GLN hat and level one modules, then in fact, level one modules are labeled. They have a basis which is labeled by such partitions. And so then this is just the gradation that E0 has, you know, grading 0, E1 has grading 1, E2 has grading 2. And so this is where this gradation comes from. And actually, if you write this formula, this is the character of GLN level 1 module, this highest weight, maybe lambda 0 here. So this is how it works. But again, my goal is to do supersymmetric analog. And so let me try to do supersymmetric analog. Now, maybe supersymmetric analog is simple to do. I mean, this is very similar to what you have previously. Okay, so you have these partitions. Okay, now partition is two sets of fermions, same number, lambdas and mu's. Okay, now since they are fermions, okay, let's try to make some of them bosons. And so what we do is we choose now two parity sequences, one parity sequence for this and one parity sequence for this, 1/2, 3/2, 5/2 for this, and so also for lambda and for mu. And then we allow repetitions in these rows. So if I allow repetitions in these rows, okay, then I prohibit if they are fermions. And the fermions means, okay, when they are fermions, when corresponding parity of that length, so S lambda I is minus one, means this is a fermion, cannot repeat. S lambda, S tilde mu I is minus one, means cannot repeat mu. And so this is what it is. And then I can call, well, I can't call superpartition anymore because the name is already taken. Let me call it S partition. So S partition is just a set of numbers like this. They are all half integers and they are weakly increasing. And at the time when it is boson, it is fermion, they cannot repeat. So this is called an S partition. Okay. And so the picture for this S partition looks like this now. So let me just do some picture. Okay, this is an example. So I took plus, 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 minus, and I took it periodically. So this is my choice of my parity. So 1/2 plus, 3/2 plus, 5/2 plus, 7/2 minus, and then I repeat. Plus, 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 minus, plus, 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 minus, and to the end as well. So using this notation, so S minus 1/2 will be the same as S 7/2. So minus, plus, plus, minus, and so on and so on. So this is my choice of parities. And then here's an example of S partition. So you see this row ends at one. And if it's at one, so because it's periodic, so then the parity of that is exactly the same as parity 1/2. And so this is like S 3/2. This parity, okay, you have to compute 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5.5. So it's the same as parity 3/2 because it's 4 periodic. And so therefore it can be repeated because this is plus. So it means it's a boson. So these two are the same rows of the same size, and so they can be repeated. Only if it end up at 3, then you cannot repeat. So if you end up at 3, the second you cannot repeat, it has to go longer. And so, but one can repeat. And so this is such a picture. And on the bottom, you can repeat You can repeat 1, 2, 3, but zero cannot, because zero is s1/2, s minus 1/2, or s tilde 1/2 is actually minus 1. So this is these are the rules. So this zero I cannot repeat again, so I cannot really put two more boxes here, for example. But okay, but three, for example, I can. So this is three and three again. So you see S partitions, they are pictures like that. So there are two partitions where sometimes you have one box sticking out. You cannot have two boxes sticking out. This is just only repeating. This is at most what you can have. And so, okay, so this is my definition of S partition. Well, so in fact, this example is related to GL3-1. And the statement is that, okay, so I can write down the same partition function as before. Okay, and the function in this case, it just has the same form as before, is absolutely the same what I had for usual partitions. So if you just compare the two, okay, I don't know if I can fit both of them here. So the only difference is that now this P factor is getting smaller, because if I can repeat, then I don't have to put a staircase there. So this is a staircase. The staircase is only for three, which is not repeated, and for zero, which is not repeated for A and B. But the formula is the same, and it turns out that you can compare this formula to some known Katz-Vakimoto formulas. So this is actually a formula for the character of GLMN level 1 module. So this is kind of a good indication that we did something wrong, something right, maybe. Okay, so this is about partitions. Any questions so far? Is it good? All right, so a little bit naive and a little bit kind of not motivated, but we did something. So now let me go to the plane partitions. Okay, so what are plane partitions? Okay, this is already less known, though, of course, very, very, very common thing. Happens many, many times in many, many, many places. So, yes, again, I asked my wife, and she said, probably this is a partition when you divide not an office, but a plane. And she meant airplane. And maybe she's right, or I don't know. But anyways, what is a plane partition? Plane partition is a sequence of normal partitions. And so you have, this is a partition, this is a partition, this is a partition, this is a partition. And they should be all kind of ordered. Ordered means that Young diagram of that should be completely inside of the Young diagram of that. Young diagram of that should be completely inside of everybody Young diagrams. So this is just a sequence of Young diagrams, and we think about each Young diagram as one level. So this is one level, second level, third level, n level. And so this is n level partition, and each partition should be inside of the other partitions. Okay, so we also have this definition of boxes. So you can count number of boxes. So you have number of boxes here, number of boxes here. And so the total number of boxes is the total sum of the boxes. And then, so how to look at this partition? Well, so it's represented by some picture. So there are many, many pictures available out there. So this is one of the pictures. And so this is a plane partition. Okay, so what is a plane partition? Again, on the first level here, I have a partition, and this partition, I counted, maybe I made a mistake, but anyway, this is 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 1, 1. This is kind of an Olympiad for kind of elementary school kids to count how many boxes you have here. So this is the first level. The second level is 4, 3, 2, 1. So this is the second boxes on the second level, third level, fourth level, and this is actually the fifth level. There is only one here. So sometimes it's represented like this. And so, okay, this is everywhere you have zero, so you have no levels. So here's height 1, height 1, height 2, height 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5. And so this is what a plane partition is. So this is a picture like that. Or you can look at it as geometrically is like that. And so the total number of boxes you can count as before, and then so on. So now the question is, what is the partition function here? So the partition function for plane partitions was computed in 19th century. And this is called McMahon function. And McMahon function is like this. So you have a McMahon function. So if you count plane partitions, then And again, I count here only boxes without any grading, because that's how it was in his paper. And so what you have is you have this formula. So you divide 1 minus q to the power I, but now everything is to the power I here. And so this is the number of partitions. Oh, I forgot to put here q to the power n. So this is a partition function for the plane partitions. Okay. And so now I would like to ask the same naive question. How do I do super analog of these plane partitions? Okay, questions. So I asked this question myself before we started our work with Luan, and I had some ideas, but none of them actually kind of had very good properties, and so I don't know how to do it. And so, okay, we are here living in a modern world. If you don't know how to do it, you try not to do it, but you ask Google, yes? So let me ask Google. And so I asked Google. So first I asked Google, what are plane partitions? And so you see, I did a search on Google for plane partitions, and you see there are many, many, many plane partitions. This is plane partition, this is plane partition, this is plane partition, and so there are many, so this is a plane partition. So Google really knows what plane partitions are. And then, okay, and then after that I asked, what is a super plane partition, plane super partition? And you see, Google is like my wife. So Google thinks that superplane partition is something which partitions a plane and has no answer here at all. Okay, so no answer from Google. So you have to do something. Okay, so what do we do? Okay, so let me now tell you the answer. What is the correct answer for the planes as partition or super partitions? So there is no term super partition, but since the previous partitions were called S partitions, maybe I will call my partitions S partitions. So what are plane S partitions? So first of all, what you have is you have a bunch of S partitions. So these are super partitions, which I described previously. First level, second level, first level, N level. And so this is a sequence of partitions, and they have to be strictly increasing. Again, this should be completely inside. This should be completely inside. This should be completely inside. That was my kind of initial guess what a plane superpartition should be. But it turns out that this is not exactly right. You have to have an additional condition. And so the condition is this. Okay, so you have this partition. This is completely inside of this partition. So this is completely inside of this partition. And the thing is, you have to prohibit to repeat the same row if it is a fermion. So this is what you are doing. So you cannot really repeat the same thing twice. So the status of the story is like this. So let me again show it on a picture first. And then I will try to explain it. So you have a picture. Okay, so this is a usual partition. So then is it going to be a super partition or not? So the answer is this. So you look from that side. So you have this line here dividing into two pieces. This is mu partition, lambda partition, and mu partition. So for lambda partition, you have some S, so you have some parity, what can be repeated below and what cannot be repeated below. And so the answer is this. So if you want to repeat things on the top like this, so it means you cannot repeat it on horizontally. Okay, so what happens is this. So for example, if I look from this side, you see these two boxes. These two boxes, they are above each other and they have the same length. So this row and this row. So I have this kind of looking from that side. Since I repeat them, I can repeat them only if the corresponding S is 1. If it is minus 1, I cannot repeat it. And the same here, I have to repeat. So this is 1/2. I'm repeating 1/2 twice. And so I have to have 1/2 to be equals to 1. And from this side, it is mu side. If I look at this, this is blue part. And so this part is repeated, and so it should be 1. So this one half should be one. So this is the rule. So whatever you repeat from this side, you cannot repeat from the other side. Okay, so let me now explain it again without pictures. So for example, can I stack this on the top of this? Or this on the top of this? So these are two layers or two levels. I want to put this on the top of this. Okay, so because of this, so this negative one means I can repeat these two things. And so it means that if I repeat it this way, I cannot put this on the top, because you see this part is repeated horizontally, therefore it cannot be repeated vertically. So the rule is opposite always. If I repeat here, I cannot repeat this on the top of this. So this is not a plain partition. And for example, this one, okay, again, I want to put this on the top of that. Can I? Well, you see here, you have the same length here, the same length. So you can put it on the top if this length has one. Otherwise not. And so it depends on the parity. This can be, this is never a plain partition. This can be a plain partition. And then on plain partitions, I always also have a grading. And this grading goes like this: 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 0, 3, 2, 1, 0. So this is the same for partitions. And then for each level, I have the same grading. So there is no change of grading if you go vertically on your picture. So this is how grading is done. And again, these are plain partitions. Because I repeat this, this has to be one. Because I repeat, this should be negative one. So repeating in this case, negative one. Repeating in this case is positive one. So this is what happens. All right. So now the question is, okay, I define something. How about the partition function? Well, it turns out that with this definition, partition function is correct. What does it mean correct? So the Cartesian function actually coincides with the character of parabolic Verma module for GL infinity, which is based on this S GL infinity, which is super GL infinity, infinity, if you wish. So this is S tilde and S. So let me try to explain. Okay, so here's my example. Okay, so I have some parity, and again, I chose some parities: plus, plus, minus, 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 plus, 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 plus. So every time you have a choice of parities, that defines for you GL infinity. GL infinity has this Dynkin diagram, which is an infinite line in both directions. And what are the roots? So between two same ones, you have a bosonic root. Between two different ones, you have a fermionic root. And so you have like this: bosonic, fermionic, bosonic, fermionic, bosonic, and so on and so on. So this is the picture which you get from this parity. So just basically, this is just a product of the corresponding parities, if you wish. And then the root diagram of that GL infinity looks like that. So these are kind of simple roots. And so they have this parity. And then on the next level, you have roots which are commutators of two neighboring roots. So for example, this is a commutator of these two. Okay, this is fermion and boson, so it becomes fermion. This is commutator of these two. This is commutator of these two. This is commutator of these two, and so on. So these are roots which are commutators of two roots. This is the second line. The third line is commutators of three roots. For example, this one is a commutator of this, and this. Okay, it's boson, because plus minus plus gives me fermion. Sorry, it's fermion. This one is plus minus plus, it's plus, and so on. So these are triple commutators. Again, if you want to do commutator and get a non-zero root, you have to commute three consecutive roots of GL infinity. So these are level two, level three, level four, level five, and so on. So you have infinitely many roots. All of them are roots. And here I only put parities, but in fact, every root has also a grading. So this is, if I call grading Z0, Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4, Z5, and so on, this will be grading Z0, Z1, this will be Z1, Z2, Z2, Z3, this will be Z-1, Z0, Z1, and so on. So we have actually grading here all the time. And the statement is that the partition function of the S-plane partitions is actually equal to parabolic Verma module. Parabolic Verma module is a module which is a free algebra generated by these roots. So this is, you know, the weight of that is something here and zero everywhere else. And so these are the only roots which participate in a character. And so in this particular case, if I just consider this example, then that's how it goes. So you have here, this one is a bosonic root, so it's 1 plus q. This one are two fermionic roots, so they have q squared because it's a double root. So you have 1 plus q squared squared. So here you have 3, so you have 1 plus q cubed squared times 1 divided by 1 minus q cubed because this is bosonic root. So it's like a polynomial. This is the like Grassmannian ring, and this is polynomial ring. So this is 1 over q. And then for 4, you have 2 on the top, 2 on the bottom. And for 5, you have 3 on, 1 on the bottom, 4 on the top, and so on and so on. So this is what partition function is. And so that's the statement. So that S partitions, actually, they have such a character, which is factorizes. And in fact, it has also a graded version. Again, if I count this as Z0 and so on and so on, I can just put here Z's and it will be the same answer. Amazingly, it is. Okay, and so in general, okay, I can write now the general theorem here. The general theorem is this. So if I take, so these are parities of simple roots. And so these are parities of arbitrary roots. Again, you just multiply these parities. These are plus or minus ones. Then the statement is that actually the partition function of S partitions, so these are S partitions, plain S partitions, just this. Same as before, you have here this plus or minus ones, and so this completely factorizes, and this is the answer. And of course, it also has a graded version. In fact, I'm not writing it here just to keep it simple. So this is it, and so this is something which tells you that maybe something is right. And so before I go any further, let me at least give you a hint how this formula is proved. So the proof is this. So let me just sketch a proof of this formula. So plain partition is just such a sequence of S partitions. So you have S partitions. And for these S partitions, actually what you define a pair of two semi-standard Young super tableau. Okay, these are very, familiar objects for those people who are doing, you know, supersymmetric algebras. How does it work? So here's an example. So suppose this is lambda, and this is lambda 1, this is lambda 1, mu 1, lambda 2, mu 2, should be upper actually indices because these are partitions, mu 1 and lambda 1, like this. Okay, so how to do it? How to record it into two tableau? Okay, so if there are two of them, so this tableau will have two columns. And the first column will be just these numbers. Okay, I shift them by one up, just so it becomes easier to see. So this becomes 1, this becomes 2, this becomes 4 and 4. And the second lambda, so there are two of them. So the second one is 3 and 2, shift by 1/2. So this one you shift. And so what you get is a pair of two tableau, T lambda and T mu. This records all lambda part of all these lambda parts, and this records of T mu. And then our conditions are such that, you know, if you have S equals 1, then the corresponding number in this tableau can be repeated horizontally, but not vertically. But minus 1 opposite. And so this is exactly familiar rules for semi-standard Young tableau. Okay, so this is a little bit different because this is reversed. Usually they increase in column going down, but here they increase going up. And so, but this is a very minor difference, in fact, not much different. And then such semi-standard tableau, where do we show up? Well, there's a famous result. Yes, question? So such semi-standard tableau, actually, they label a basis of a reducible GLMN module. These are semi-standard tableau, with highest weight given by the shape of this diagram. And so therefore, what we just did is, so this bijection tells us that this partition function actually is equal to the sum over all lambdas, of all shape lambdas, of products of characters of simple GLMN or GLSK modules. M and N actually depend on the parity S, and this depend on the parity S tilde. So whatever happens, happens, but we have such a product, and that's what we have. So we have this, and then the statement is that once I have this, this is again a very familiar thing, and there is a so-called GLMN GLSK duality. So this is a well, for GLMN duality, this is actually very famous and long known, but this supersymmetric analog is also due to Wong and Cheng. So they did it a few years back. So what we know is that this duality, such a product, is actually corresponds to the character of polynomials or skew polynomials, Grassmann algebra, as you want to call it, in variables Xij, which form a matrix. So this matrix organized in such a way that the columns are vector representations of this GL, and the rows are vector representation of this GLSK. And then if you take Grassmann or polynomial algebra of all these generators, so then the statement is that you get exactly such a sum. But the character of this, okay, this is just a polynomial algebra. So this is, we are computed already today several times. And so this is very easy to do. And that gives me exactly the formula in Ethereum. So that's how it's done. Using this duality, we can obtain such a result. Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell you about supersymmetric Young tableau and super analogs of plane partitions. And now let me tell you why and where did I come with ideas and why do I care and so on and so on. And so the answer is what I'm doing is actually I'm doing representations of quantum toroidal algebras. And so, there are many algebras out there, and we study them in different ways. And so usually it all starts at simple algebras, SLN, for example, or something. And so you have this algebra G, and this has actually a quantum analog, a deformation depending on one parameter. It's a quantum group. And then the next level is you take current algebras. So what you do is you take polynomial currents in here, and they also have a quantization, which is called Youngian. And then you go to affine algebras, and it becomes even more interesting. So the affine algebras, they can be obtained as current. So this is called actually a loop algebra. So you take Laurent polynomials with values in G. Then you have to do central extension and so on. So let me not worry about this. But this also can be obtained immediately from a Katz table. So a Katz from a Cartan matrix, So it has two realizations. One is a Katz-Moody algebra and one is an affine algebra, such a thing. And there are corresponding quantum affine algebras, and they also have two different realizations. One is called Drinfeld realization. This is the current realization. And the second one is called Drinfeld-Jimber realization. And so this is exactly like that. And so the quantum toroidal algebras is the next level. So what you want to do is you want to do now double loop algebras maybe. And so, so these algebras, in fact, are studied very intensively now by many, many people. I have no idea actually what exactly, the good results are and why they are so interesting. So this part on a quantum case, this is really something which is, me personally, I was avoiding studying it for as long as I could because I thought it was too difficult and so on and so on. But the quantum toroidal algebras actually appear in many places in integrable systems. So I'm interested in integrable systems. And so many integrable systems actually come from these toroidal algebras. And they also appear in many other areas in physics and mathematics. So you can't just avoid doing these algebras. So morally speaking, they correspond to this. However, I'm not sure, these algebras have infinite center. And so this is not completely clear what these algebras are, but they are studied at least. So anyway, this is the level what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about such an algebras, and not only this, but actually I'm going to do super. So everything can be done super. So you can do here super algebras. You can do super here. So everything has the name super to it. And as you know, every time you add super, you have to do extra work. And so here, many things has been done, but already on that level, so we are far behind. For example, if I'm not mistaken, So dream filterization, dream gym realizations are not really written or compared for all cases in super affine algebras. But anyways, and what I want to do is I want to do put here super as well. So this I don't know. This is not my job at the moment. Super. So and that's what we did with Luan actually a few years ago. So we introduced algebras, quantum toroidal algebras, super algebras corresponding to super things. And so, okay, how to understand these algebras? Okay, let me tell you a little bit about this. So the usual thing is about these algebras is a Dynkin diagram. Yes, you have a Dynkin diagram, and if you have a simple algebra, so then you have a finite Dynkin diagram, and for each node you have creation operators, annihilation operators, and Cartan generators. And so for each one of them. So if you go to current algebras, then FI, KI, they become half currents. So they just kind of currents in one direction. And so that's what you do. And if you go to affine algebras, then they become full currents. This is full current, this full current, and KI actually become plus or minus two half currents here. And so that's what you do. Or alternatively, you can use affine Dynkin diagram. Then you don't have currents. You have EI, FI, KI without any currents. So this is two descriptions of the same thing. And for the quantum toroidal algebras, you have a fine diagram, but for each node of the diagram, you actually have a current. EI is full current, FI is full current, and KI are two half currents. And so these are the relations. So let me just show you the relations a little bit. So again, depending how much you know about quantum groups, this is either easy to understand or impossible to understand. So in type A, actually, the quantum toroidal algebras depend not on one parameter, but rather on two parameters. So this is just a matter of life, and the reason is because you have a loop in a Dynkin diagram. So because of that loop, you can actually twist along that loop, and that brings a different parameter, different quantization parameter. If you look about algebras, for example, of type B, A, C, they depend only on one parameter. But in any case, this is just a two-parameter algebras, and it's convenient to use three parameters so that the product is one, only two independent parameters. And then we have this EI, FI, and KI plus minus, which I promised to you. This is full current, and this is two half currents. We also have central element, but okay, I'll send it equal to one immediately because in all representations it will act by one today. And so, and then I have the relations. And so the relations are actually very familiar if you do any quantum groups. So this is always like that. So you have some linear factors here. So Aij, Bij, Dij, these are some numbers which can be determined from Q1, Q2. But in any case, these are the relations. So EE relations go like this, KF, KF, and so this is like that. And then we have E and F relations as always again. So commutator is Cartan. There are SER relations, but okay, let me not worry about SER relations today, and so on. Okay, so how does it look? So, okay, this is super case, so which is not maybe well known, but in any case, let me just again say. So for super case, the Young diagram, the Dynkin diagram has some fermionic roots and some bosonic roots. Okay, so this is standard parity, so-called examples when plus, plus, plus are all together, minus, minus, minus are all together. This is the case of GL34. And so in this case, these numbers are like this. So this is important for the future. So let me just say. So if I go Fi, Fi plus one, so next ones. So then the pole of this thing is Q3 inverse, Z minus Q3 inverse here. And if I go in the minus region, this is actually Q3. And here Q1 and Q1 inverse. That's how it goes. So this is in this particular case. Again, this Aij and Bij can be determined by some rule, which I'm not going to discuss because I just don't have much time for that. Okay, and so, and this case actually corresponds to a choice of parities in the future like this. So this is always periodic choice. And so I have, three, four, so three pluses and four minuses. And then to compare it to what I said before, I have to really extend it by pluses, pluses, minus, minuses in periodic way, left and right. And also, you see, there is a shift here. So in my kind of representation theoretical picture, I have 0, 1, 2, 3, and here I have half integers. And so you can do this shift actually either way. But anyway, I do it like this. 1/2 tilde becomes a 0, 1/2 becomes 1, 3/2, and so on and so on. So this shift, again, I will explain where it comes from maybe later. So, but in any case, this is a choice of parity corresponds to such Deng diagram, corresponds to such algebra. And now this algebra actually has representations. But before going to representation, let me tell you a few properties of this algebra. So these are some facts about the algebra. Okay, so I can choose this algebra, you know, different parities. Again, 3 and 4, it means I have to choose 3 pluses and 4 minuses in this picture. I can mix them up, I can change it around, but as long as I have 3 pluses and 4 minuses, as in GLMN case, toroidal algebras are also isomorphic. This is a theorem which we proved in one of our papers. So they're all isomorphic for different parities, as before. Now, if I take this diagram and I forget zero node, so forget about zero node and just take the rest, then this is just quantum GLMN. Quantum GLMN affine, not toroidal, but affine if you forget zero node. And it comes naturally in a Drinfeld realization because I have currents, and so this is Drinfeld realizations. And because I set my central element to be one, it is actually level 0, 1, my algebra. So no level. But then instead, again, I could have zero modes of all these currents and take all of them, including zero mode. If I take zero modes, then in fact, this is also GL infinity, GLMN affine, but now in Drinfeld-Jimber realization. So you see these two realizations, they actually come together, but you have two different algebras now. One is in this realization, another in this realization. So both together of them, they generate the whole toroidal algebra. And the picture is actually very, very, very symmetric. So there is, this is called what is called Mickey automorphism, which we also proved exists. And so such an automorphism of algebra can actually interchange one algebra to another algebra. This automorphism is highly non-trivial, and isomorphism between Drinfeld realization and Drinfeld-Jimber realization in general is impossible to write explicitly on all generators. One direction you can, the other direction you cannot. And so this is, but it exists. So that's a statement. Yes, and yeah, we have actually another central element here, which is the product of all zero modes of k's here. To have Mickey automorphism, you cannot set the previous C to be one. So this C will go to the previous central element. So you need both central elements to have Mickey automorphism. And then, yes, and then there is the grading, which I always promised. And so the grading is this. EI has a grading like ith grading. FI also ith grading, minus one and plus one. And so together you have M plus N gradings. And so this is what my colors will be from zero to M plus N minus one. So these are my gradings. And finally, I also have a Hopf algebra structure, which is great. And so this Hopf algebra structure is unfortunately topological only, or fortunately, so this is depends on your point of view. So it means that these are infinite series here. So if you try to multiply it out, you get infinite series. And since it's infinite series, so it can be not well defined in some tensor products, but sometimes yes, sometimes not. But this is a usual story for Drinfeld coproduct again. And now let me go to the modules. Okay, so we have different modules for this algebra. And my first module, which I'm going to do, is this is the module which you have to think about. This is evaluation module of the vector representation. So this is what happens for GLN, for example, hat. It has such a module, and toroidal algebra also has such a module. And so such a module is like this. So it looks like that. So you have a chain of vectors. So these are vectors. U is evaluation parameter. And what you do is F0 actually goes from here to here. F1 goes from here to here. F2 goes from here. And just periodically it goes again and again and again and again. And E go backwards. So such a simple module. It's kind of a one-line module. And okay, I wrote here formulas how it acts. I'm not sure how much you are kind of you can get it in such a fast talk, but in any case, k acting diagonally on each element, and k acts like a rational function, either this rational function or this rational function. But e and f act by delta function. So this delta function, sometimes multiplied by constant, not very important, but the important part is the support of the delta function. The support of this delta function is what is called L bar. And this is the coordinates in the super world. So you see usual coordinates, how do we go? We go plus one, plus one, plus one, plus one. And these are coordinates on a number line here. But because of that picture, which I showed to you, you see, you have here Q3 inverse, but here you have Q3. So here I count one direction, but around kind of the corner, I count the other direction. And so therefore, I go not by one here, but by S1, by S2, by S3, by S4. And so this is what is called bar. This I denote bar, and these are coordinates and this super line, if you wish. Important part here is that M is actually never equal to N. So this part I don't know how to handle, because if M equals N, it means you periodically get the same coordinate again and again and again. And this is a very different story. But M is not equal to N, then all coordinates kind of eventually grow up, grow up, grow up. And so that's what we have. And that's what is used here. On that line, the action is according to this super coordinate. And then there is also another vector representation, which I call covector representation. So this is also one line representation, but now, okay, I put indices on the top and you see it's opposite. F decreases indices. It was increasing before, now it is decreases indices like this. And coordinate is here Q3. Previous was Q1 inverse, now it is Q3 inverse if you count this way. And so these are vector representations, and so you can write them and check all the relations explicitly because these are very simple representations. And then they are used as building blocks to construct more complicated representations. So the next representations I can construct is called Fock spaces. And the Fock spaces construct it like this. So you take vector covector, vector covector, vector covector, and then you shift it by Q2 squared, and so on, such an infinite product. So such an infinite product, okay, it's not well defined. So if you just try to use coproduct, it's not well defined. It's not clear what it means, infinite product. It's not stabilizing. But anyway, all these technical problems can be solved. And the statement is this. If you take this vector, minus 1, 0, minus 1, 0, minus 1, 0, so then this vector is actually killed by all E generators. And so this is highest weight. And what you obtain acting on this vector is a well-defined module. Okay, so here it is. So you have such vectors parameterized by lambda and by mu. So you can increase this one because you act by F. You increase these guys and you decrease that one because minus here. Increase, decrease, increase, decrease. And this lambda mu, what you get here is exactly the S partitions I was talking about. So I didn't invent them combinatorially, in fact. So what we did with Luan, actually, maybe not even me invented it, but Luan did. So what we did is we found the submodule generated by this module, and we saw that actually it's parameterized by S partitions. And this module which you get is actually a reducible highest weight module. It's tame, it has all nice properties, and the highest weight is like this. This is level one module for quantum toroidal superalgebra, in fact. And so, and this is the picture, one more time, maybe I should say what it is. So this is a super partition I have here. And this line corresponds to this U5. So you see you have ending at 5. And so this is a part of this V vector, VV representation. So you have 5. So this is the next factor. This is VUQ2 here shifted. This is the next one. Columns are Ws. And so all these have meaning. So this is VVQ squared shifted Q squared. Q2 squared shifted, Q2 cubed shifted, and so on and so on. So this is what this picture represents. And you see, I chose here V first, W second, V first, W second. So on that picture, it means that actually my zero now not split in half, but it belongs to the right side. I could have chosen opposite, then zero would split and belong to the bottom side. Then my parities would shift the other way. So remember, I shifted parity by one half. And that's what you need to do representation theory. You shift it either one way, one half, or another way, one half. And so this is, I shifted, and that's what I got the picture. And actually, the action here is very, very nice of all generators of quantum toroidal algebras. So if you try to act by F, F adds boxes here. And they adds boxes, and it acts by delta function. And how to find delta function? You just count the coordinates of this thing. You see, you have coordinate Q1 inverse here and Q3 inverse here. This way Q2. And so if you count, you know, the coordinates of the box, that will be exactly the support of the delta function. And so, for example, if you act by F6, it can add box here or box here or box here. If you add by F5, it does not have any boxes to add because you cannot add 5 anywhere in that partition. And E would kill boxes like this. Okay, Kx diagonally, and so anyways, the formulas are very nice. They look like Pierre-like formulas, like if you multiply polynomials by, say, product of Xi's or something. So this is very, very similar formulas. They're all very nice and very beautiful and very tractable, what is good about this. And then, you know, this is my S partitions. And to do plane partitions, I have to do this construction one more time and construct what is called McMahon modules. So McMahon modules are like this. Now you take Fock spaces, which you constructed in a previous case, and you multiply them, but now shifting by Q2 inverse, Q2 minus 2, and so on and so on. And once you shift it this way, well, again, this is not well defined completely, but if you start correctly and you just use only plane as partitions, then what you do is you get a module. And the basis of this module will be parameterized by plane S partitions, as we discussed and as I presented. That's where the notion of S partition came from. And in fact, its highest weight is given like this, K minus K inverse. It depends on one parameter K and 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 here. So you see, this was a parabolic Verma module. So parabolic Verma module has one non-trivial parameter k, and this is what this k parameter is. You can introduce it here when you're doing the same infinite construction. And so that gives you plane S partitions. And so, okay, I was told by Slava not to go over 60 minutes, and so it's been exactly 60 minutes. So let me stop here. And I would like to thank you for listening to me. And of course, we have a super analog of this. Super thank you, yes.
I think Ivan is having technical problems, so that then I will ask. So are there any questions, please, or comments? So I wanted to ask Zhenya the following. So this Fock module that you constructed, you realized via the S partitions or plane partitions with a nice explicit action of the algebra.
Yes.
But this is particular example, right?
Of? Of so- such. No, there are many, many modules. So, of course, I only scratched the surface and I just told you the most easy ones to show. There are more modules for...
Right, so my question was exactly, what is the class of modules you can realize this way?
Oh, there is plenty. And so, this is not an easy question. So, okay, so first of all, of course, McMahon module is the most fundamental one. And this Fock spaces, in fact, can be obtained from McMahon specializing K. So if I specialize K to be equals Q2, then it will have a irreducible subfactor, which is actually a Fock space. So McMahon is kind of the most important one module, the McMahon is. Mm-hmm. And then what you have to do is you have to multiply those McMahons together, and then you have to obtain more and more and more and more. And in fact, we have actually construction of McMahon module, which corresponds not to plane partition, but plane partitions with boundaries. So this is a common thing when you have boundaries. So you are kind of have some kind of stands or bleachers, you know, on each side you have some partitions which are prohibited from very beginning. And so such modules also appear, and we also construct them in our paper. And this is, again, only a start. There are many, 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 many of them. So what we are really studying is a category of highest weight modules for quantum toroidal algebra. And it is amazing that we have a huge, huge class of modules which are tame. So tame mm-hmm. is very important for us. So tame means all Ki, they kind of distinguish, they have different joint eigenvalues. Right. And so there is a huge family of tame modules. It includes Fox, McMahon, and many tensor products, and many more. And actually, I don't know the full classification even in the even case. This is about supersymmetric case. But in the even case, even I don't know how to classify all tame modules. There are many of them, and there are more interesting examples which I don't mention. They correspond to what is called cylindrical partitions, for example, plane partitions, when you kind of have some, you have some conditions first and last should be kind of related. And then there are many things. There are many things which you can obtain. I don't have a full classification of this.
Mm-hmm. And what happens if you take a classical limit?
Of?
If you take you go back to the classical.
So story. Again, let me say. So I don't know any good use of this classical thing. So. No, these algebras are studied, and there are several groups of people who study such things.
No, that I know, but
I don't know if they have good representation theory or if something or whatever. I have really not a good idea about these algebras themselves. Mm-hmm. And in fact, this is only double limit of this, and this is another kind of issue. If you want to take limit of that, first you get not this, but you get actually difference operators. Not like this. T and S should not be commuting variables. They should be they should form this quantum plane or this Weyl algebra as you wish. Mm-hmm. This is that algebra has the same representation as MacMahon. But if you generalize all the way to here, then I don't know.
Mm-hmm. And what happens? Is it possible to take a triple quantum?
Look,
three variables.
So yeah. You can take here as many as you like, and again, people are studying, I think, those things. You can do whatever you like, which is very easy. But again, I try not to go too deep and not to go too difficult unless I have some motivation for this. These algebras actually appear. So if you take, for example, K-theoretic Hall algebra or something, or so you just see this algebra. I mean, you cannot avoid it. Or if you study some BPS states of toric variety, you have Toric Calabi Yao threefold. And so you study BPS states or something. So you see this algebra. This is not something which I kind of invented by simple kind of doing 1, 2, 3. This algebra, mm-hmm. I was forced. And for me, the main motivation actually was studying affine Gaudin models. Affine Gaudin models is still not even, I don't even know what it is. But I know this is should be, if you take from here R matrix, transfer matrix from here, and you take a limit, then you should get something which is called a fine Gaudin model, which nobody understands. We understand this part better than Gaudin model, but the Gaudin model, a fine Gaudin model, is related to many things. For example, it is related to this quantum KdV flows, famous ones, you know, this series of work, Bajanov, Lukyanov, and Zamolodchikov. And so, you know, in order to understand that, you just have to go here, and that's mm-hmm. my motivation. If I need to go to triple to understand something, I would. But at the moment, I don't know. And I have no reason to do this.
Right.
Okay.
Any other questions? Abhiman, please.
I had problems with sound. No, yes, I'm asking also. Well, I have a very naive question. You know, classical partitions are related with Young diagrams and representation of symmetric groups. What
right.
about plane partitions?
Yeah, so yeah.
Classical object, some kind of.
Well, so yeah, this is the object. I told you the object. So the plane partitions are related to parabolic Verma modules of GL infinity.
Okay.
This is one thing. Or it is related to representations of quantum toroidal algebras. This is another thing. So these are the things which I know. And when you say representations of symmetric group, you see, you mean different. What I mean, take this parabolic Verma module and a basis is parametrized by these partitions. When you say it's related to symmetric group, you mean different representations are parametrized by partitions. So you see, this is different thing. So yeah, to me, you know, more kind of correct analogy is you take usual partitions, this is the basis in a space of symmetric polynomials. You take symmetric polynomials, then the basis there is parameterized by partitions. So that is kind of my would be analogy to that. But even better analogy, so this would be the first, the very first, as I presented, the very first thing, how you do it naively, the very first thing. But what I'm doing today is when partitions actually parameterize level one GLN modules. You take level one GLN hat modules, you know, you take a fine GLN, you take level one module, say lambda one or lambda two, lambda three, then it is parameterized by usual partitions with the gradient which I was trying to explain. And that's kind of the starting point. Then you can do all this all other things and you go. I don't know what is how to do if you start from symmetry group, you know, how to go next. What is next? I have no idea. I mean, is there any this is
this okay, does not more questions? More questions, comments? Well, I cannot see many questions. So let us thank Evgeny again. Thank you very much. Make an announcement for the next Thursday. The next Thursday we will have two talks. At 12, Brazilian time. At 12 we will have talk by Shavkat Ayupov from Institute of Mathematics, Uzbekistan Academy of Sciences. He will speak on local and two local derivations and automorphism of octonions, octonion algebras. And then at 2 o'clock, we will have a talk by Jose Maria Perez Izquierdo from the University of Rioja, Spain. He will speak on some aspects of the three non-associative algebra. So two talks, one at 12 and another one 2 hours later at 4, usual time. Okay, so thanks everybody again. Thank you very much. Спасибо большое, Женя. Такой насыщенный доклад. Very, very good.
Спасибо.
Okay. Thanks everybody for participating. Till the next Thursday. Bye-bye.